Well, either you're closing your eyes to a situation you do not wish to acknowledge, or you are not aware of the caliber of disaster.
The Emperor has been expecting you.
You're gonna get your mind right.
Warning. Common sense incoming.
Alive. It's alive!
Warning. This contains explicit material suitable for children.
Great heavens. What kind of radio show is this?
This is The Blab.
Our system is set up for our politicians, whether they're Republicans or Democrats, to make us not like each other so they can keep their grasp of money and power. We're so stupid following our politicians, whether they're Republicans or Democrats. And their only job is, hey, let's make these people not like each other. We don't live in their neighborhoods. We all got money. Let's make the whites and blacks not like each other. Man, I think most white people and black people are great people. I really believe that in my heart.
Well, there's a very kumbaya sort of approach to the whole thing of what's going on.
Yes, I was like, it was refreshing to hear somebody say it.
Charles Barkley. I was tempted to break into a chorus of We Are the World, but, you know, that would sound cynical and snarky, and I wouldn't want to do that. So, but let me, it's interesting that you sent me that this week, and I gave it a listen and a look, and I said, okay, and you had asked if we could talk about that in the front end, and I said, sure, you betcha. Partly because, well, it's you, and you ask.
And I ask so nicely.
You do, and you clean up your mess after, too. And but second, it's interesting the way the synchronicity of this stuff works, because I actually had something that I wanted to come into, and it didn't necessarily have to be the start of the show, but I think it kind of dovetails at the same time.
We are so dovetailing.
We're dovetailing right off the bat. Well, it's because we're coordinated fellows. So right off the bat, hold the thought, put a pin in Charles for a second, and we'll deal with that. But I wanted to put this out there, to include that in there, as we get witty and we get wise, if we do say ourselves. But, you know, because when all things considered, we are just two guys talking. And whom you're asking, we talk about getting out of this house. This applies to the other thing that you had sent me a couple of days earlier than that. And that was the report that was done on the report by your two buds there on the podcast, vidcast thing called Rising.
Oh, yeah.
Talking about the 60 Minutes segment on Ron DeSantis.
Mm-hmm.
And the way I see it connecting in this myriad of medulla that is my brain is that Charles was talking about what I referred to last week when you and I were talking about this in a different context was what I call the Emilio Largo syndrome, where what he's basically saying is what I said was what we talked about, was that the trick is to get everybody shooting at each other.
Right.
While they're robbing the bank.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that kind of what he's saying?
Yeah.
In so many words.
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah. So as long as they can keep no matter what the sides are and the parts. The basic premise of what he talks about when he says we're stupid, collectively we, and I take exception with the term we, but many are, as proved by the results of these elections. But let me lay this as the other groundwork, and then we can just do a comprehensive chit-chat on the whole thematic, and along with the 60 Minutes thing. And I'm going to surprise you a little bit, I bet. The nutshell, for those who aren't familiar with this thing, 60 Minutes did a segment which they were pretty much slamming Ron DeSantis as the governor of Florida and making him out to be a bandit and an outlaw, and they just don't like him, and they haven't along the way. And the basic piece was that he had taken money from the grocery chain Publix, which is prominent in that part of the country, to award them vaccination site status to make extra bucks and et cetera. And let me just, I didn't watch the 60 Minute piece. I haven't watched 60 Minutes in years.
Right.
Not that I dislike it or that I disagree with it, just that I don't care anymore. I haven't seen Saturday Night Live in 20 years
once
either.
Mike Wallace was gone, I kind of lost interest in
it. Yeah, Morley Safer was my guy, but that's, okay. Old school. But the 60 Minutes piece, and get ready because you're going to need to hold your chair for this one. The 60 Minutes piece, or at least the chunks that I saw of it in the report these guys were doing about the 60 Minutes piece, the piece, its editing, its general tone, is inarguably an attempt to discredit DeSantis.
Right.
Nobody can deny that. 60 Minutes does, but, you know, fuck them. What do we care?
Exactly.
But or more and when I thought about it, and this was my impression when I was listening to it, there's a thing under the thing, because you know me, I love the things under the thing. First, there's legitimate smoke anytime a private business appears to benefit from donating large sums of money to political candidates. And your buddies on Rising So Much has said that.
Right, right.
And he did take $100,000 that we know of from the public's chain. Mm-hmm. And that's an unfortunate circumstance of politics, whether it was a pay for play, play for pay, whatever you want to call it, or not, who's to say and who's to know. The thing under the thing is that for me, and I think a lot of people, is that DeSantis is guilty by association. And when I say guilty, I'm saying metaphorically, and keep in mind for the next 2 or 3 minutes, I am not defending 60 Minutes. I'm not even necessarily agreeing with their approach. What I'm doing in my own brain and expressing it outwardly is I'm explaining how these things happen and how these contexts come to be seen in the perspective that happens, perception being reality. And by guilty by association, what I mean is DeSantis has and continues to associate and associated himself with Trump and Trumpism since moment one of day one. He wants to be the Florida Trump. This is the same Trump and the same Trumpism that from the moment the orange Marvel came down the golden escalator, injected, nobody else did. He injected and wrote it into the White House. Fake news, alternate facts, alternate truths, total decimation of anything and everything that didn't agree absolutely and totally 100% at all times with anything Donald had to say or anything Donald had to do, no matter how ridiculous it was. And the 60 Minutes piece coming after DeSantis is an overreaction. It discredits them journalistically. But again, asterisk, I'm not defending what they said or what they did, but the intellectual reason they did it is because they got guns blazing. They want that shit to end. If they're sloppy about it, I get sloppy about it. I'm a reasonably intelligent, I'm a real intelligent guy, and I get lost in the emotion of it and just want that shit to go away.
Right.
I made myself a little note here. This, I think, underscores what I honestly believe needs to happen for the GOP, the Republican Party in America, if it is to survive, has to happen to get any kind of support from anybody except the diehard Trumpist mouth droolers and the "if it ain't on Fox News, it's bullshit" club, okay? And this is what it is. They have to disavow Donald Trump now. They have to disavow Trumpism now. They have to offer, we've been down this road already a few times this year, reasonable, intelligent, it can be passionate, it can be strong, it can be firm, it can even be controversial. Conservatism.
Right.
In alternate or in opposition to or in contest with or in conflict with, if that's what it takes. Never did, but he's not, I was going to say he's not the problem anymore. He's temporarily not the problem. We'll see how this plays out. But Trumpism is. It's the old, the tumor's been excised from the body, but the cancer, the poison is still circulating around in there. Okay. Now, let's full circle back to Charles Barkley talking about politicians and what they do and how they do. The mechanism of politics kind of dictates that this is the way it's going to be done anyway. But what's happened is it's been so negatively inflamed and increased. It's gasoline.
Right.
You know, the cheesy metaphor would be that if the bullshit of politics was a moderately raging bonfire 6 years ago, it's fucking Mount Vesuvius now as a result of this poison that's in the system and this continued
enabling it. It a one-sided poison.
No.
Why did Trumpism even rise?
It doesn't matter why. What happened is it didn't work, and all it did was inflame the issue. And reasonable people, okay? Why? That's blame
game. No, but I'm saying the left got so far left. The pendulum swung so far left, and that's why people were like, "Whoa."
Okay, if it satisfies your everybody does it button for me, let me finish the thought. If it satisfies your everybody does it button for me to say that the Democrats need to get their fucking shit together too, then there you go. Okay. But nobody's embracing. I don't see anything happening in a power position. I don't see the White House functioning that way anymore.
What?
No, I'm not. I'm talking about the kind of shit. I'm talking about Trumpism. I'm talking. If you don't like
the far left rhetoric is crazy, Sky. Come on, man.
Do you understand what I'm saying when I say the power? No, you don't. If you're saying to me it's the same thing, I'm not seeing the president of the United States acting like that. I'm not seeing the low road being taken. I'm not seeing the cheap shot shit going on. Policy differences, you bet. That's always going to be the way it goes, and whether it plays out or not, et cetera. And you know what? To a certain extent, I'll give you this, and I'm not going to apologize for it anymore. I'm not going to back off of it anymore, and right. I'm not going to be gracious anymore. Trumpism is outrageously worse. The right is outrageously worse. Ted fucking Cruz is outrageously worse. This shit needs to die, and it needs to die now. If it doesn't, laugh if you want. If it doesn't, it's an endless spiral, and what's going to happen is the other side will respond in kind. You know, the Republican Party honestly has an amazingly tremendous opportunity to do something.
I agree.
That would absolutely upend the process forever. You know what it is?
What's that?
Stop playing, I know you are, but what am I? Stop falling back behind the excuse that everybody else does it. Stop saying you're just as bad as I am. Take and grab hold of the one thing nobody else has got a hold of, the fucking high road.
That is true. And I wish they would take
it. And this is the point of what I'm saying. And I think the point of what Charles was saying in a generic way, but out articulating it, this is where the problem lies. And it's not like, okay, we've gone back to with the elimination of Trump, put Biden in there. Now the Republicans gather their steam. They gain, and it turns back into some semblance of the way it used to be. They're still paying homage to this guy. They're still traipsing. They're giving him fucking awards. They're playing the game. Now, whether that play, I personally don't honestly think anymore that he represents a clear and present danger, because I think his bullshit is going to eventually sink him completely. Even the Republic, this bullshit that went on in Florida this past weekend, where he spent his entire speech at the whatever that was, again, another 2 hours of poor, pitiful me, and they treated right. me mean and all that. And even the hard nose, with the exception of the wife beater mouth drillers, everybody's just going, oh, for God's sake, man.
Yeah,
can we please have something along those lines?
As Dan Crenshaw said, it's still early. He's fading in the background. He will be.
We'll see.
You know, but
the opportunity, and this is the part I said. We talked about demagoguery along the way, because that's what Trump wants to be, and that's how he presents himself to be. And again, when I say Trump from here on out, I need to be more disciplined. I need to say Trumpism, the act of following that approach. This idiot in Texas, who is it? Cornyn. Kanyon, the one who on the interview yesterday on the Sunday shows or Monday or Sunday show said he actually said he wonders if Biden is actually governing the country because he's not tweeting very much. This is a Republican senator in the United States Senate who is genuinely concerned that the president of the United States isn't doing his job because he's not tweeting about how pitiful everybody is treating him on a day in, day out basis. He's kind of busy doing shit. Okay. That's what a tremendous wasted opportunity this is for Republicans and the conservative cause to step up and do the right fucking thing. And who cares what Democrats are doing? Take the high road and run with it.
Because they're doing shit. That's for sure.
Okay.
And well, this is what I got from the Barkley interview. The new, and I'm going to use the air quotations.
All right.
I don't think the new liberals actually know the definition of racism. Of race. I don't think they know the actual definition.
I'm laughing with you, not at you.
Yeah, do you get what I'm saying?
Well, give me an example of what you're talking
about. All right, here's an example. And everything they do reinforces this. The knee-jerk reaction to anything that makes a new liberal uncomfortable is to call you a racist.
Mm-hmm.
That's the go-to.
Citizens are racist. Yep. Citizens are racist.
Exactly. And you know what I'm talking about, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And so it doesn't matter the forum. It doesn't matter the issue, the discussion. If you don't see things exactly their way, mm-hmm. you're a racist. They want to end you. They want to end your job. They want to bury you forever.
Well, it's a hot, and I'm not, again, I always have to asterisk, hopefully at some point down the line in months and years to come, I won't have to anymore, but I will, by saying my responses to these things 90% of the time are not defenses. They are intellectual opinions of how these things happen, not that they're right, the right thing right. to happen. Again, it happens because they know, those people who respond that way know that that's the hot button that the masses who aren't all that bright or don't pay all that much attention or react emotionally or viscerally won't.
Right.
And they go for it.
I actually think that's what Charles Barkley was talking about.
He's absolutely correct.
You know, and
But here's the other part of this. Let's go to the next step of that.
Okay.
All right. And if we had the opportunity to talk with him, and this is, I would say to him exactly the same thing I'm saying to you. And I'm not doing it in a point counterpoint way. I'm asking it as a legitimately right. honest question. Okay, there's the problem. You nailed it, buddy. Half court. Nothing but net. Now what's the solution?
Yeah. That's the tough thing.
Well, yeah.
But
y'all stop being mean to each other now and get along with everybody.
But the thing that always tickles me about this new breed of liberals is their answer to racism is to be even more racist. And I'll give you an example. They forced the Major League Baseball to move the All-Star game from Atlanta, which is a minority city, to Colorado, basically a white state, 70 to 75% white. Mm-hmm. So their answer to be,
with the exception of what's her name, the gun.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, there you go. Because the Republican side is doing so very well in Colorado.
But what I'm saying is, they're hurting the minority communities to make a point about racism, and pumping more money into the white devil.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, they don't actually know what racism is, and that it kills me.
I respect them
if they weren't so stupid.
I don't want to split hairs. I think they know exactly what it is. I think it's a strategy. It's a poor strategy, and it's going to backfire in all kinds of different ways down the line. But they're not stupid. There's stupid people in any occupation, but this is one of those things. It's the same thing with the real strategist types who really know what they're doing on the right side of things. You know, on the right wing side, who do this stuff. Why do they? When you said racism is their automatic go to for any time, anything, et cetera, okay, let's, and I'm just spitballing here. Demographically speaking, the right wing has, who want to all count, they can come back with and frequently do immigration.
Right.
The hordes coming across the border.
Right.
Play the fear card.
Mm-hmm.
Racism is the fear card for the Democrats.
You're right.
Yeah, I know.
You're
and, right. And immigration and others, racism and others. This, again, magically dovetails, which is why I put it all together the way I did before I went, was to say, okay, there's the problem. Now what's the solution? Beyond just wringing our hands or batting the same fucking birdie back and forth, time in, day in, day out, that's going back and forth with these things.
Here's the solution. And it starts with
Krispy Kreme.
No, it starts with the administrations, the incoming administrations. And I'll start as far back as, you know, from Bush to Obama, Obama to Trump.
From Memphis to St. John.
From Trump to Biden. If there is a good policy, a policy that is working, don't tear it up because it has somebody else's name on it. Trump did that shit with a bunch of Obama stuff that was actually good policies.
Yep.
Biden tore up all of Trump's immigration policies, and it's a fucking mess down there. But we won't know because there's a media blackout down there, but it is a fucking mess. 177,000 people came across the border, were apprehended last month.
Well, there had to be some nice people in there somewhere.
Well, yeah, you know, they can't all be rapists and criminals. But yeah, so that would be step one. A good idea is a good idea.
I agree. Now, I'm just playing the game here.
Sure.
I'm volleying back and I'm agreeing with you. So don't, you know, that's the what there. That's another what. Give me the how.
Well, that is a how. That's a step. Baby steps, Scott.
No, you said.
Don't. Yeah.
Biden shouldn't be tearing up things that Trump did.
And Trump shouldn't have torn up.
Okay, Obama, but that was then. I'm big on fuck the past. Rearview mirror don't do shit for anybody. Let's jump on Joe.
But I'm saying two wrongs don't make a right.
That, but do that, when I say that's the what's the how, what I'm saying is the what is Joe need to be not doing that.
Right.
Now, how do you get Joe not to do that? That's the how. Yeah. And how'd you get Donald not to do that?
He couldn't.
And there you go.
Right.
The name of the game is leverage, always and everywhere. And I don't have magic solutions. Okay. I will tell you this, in a kind of a sideways thing, this occurred to me just doing my post-nap thought process when I came back to consciousness today. And I accidentally scrolled through something, and the headline was Trump lashes out at, and I didn't read any farther because all's well in the world, because if Donald's got something to lash out at, then everything's good.
Yeah.
But I said, you know, and I know I've said this to you before in our conversations and here on the old podcast, that, and this kind of goes along with what I said a minute ago about the Republican Party not recognizing or not taking full advantage of the tremendous opportunity that lays in front of them, because the high road is just laying there, bare-ass, naked, and empty.
Right.
Pick that fucker up and you can run with it, and a lot of people
will follow.
Yeah. Probably the bulk of the Electoral College will follow. So you got to ask yourself, when we're collectively throwing words like stupid around, how stupid do you have to be not to see that and not pick it up and do it? Oh my God, let's do good shit and fake the hell out of everybody. Wow, how cool is that? But my post-nap thought was this. If I was 50 years old and now, I think, knowing what I know and things being what they are, I think I'd take a shot at running for office. But, and I'm serious about this, as serious as it can be. Fuck the city council, fuck the state senate, fuck the House of Representatives, and fuck the United States Senate. I'm going straight for the big prize. I'm going to run for president. And you know what? I can win. And I'll tell you how. The core of my strategy. I have a lot of ability. I'm a real smart guy. And I know what a demagogue is. And I know what demagogues do. And I know how demagoguery can succeed. The name of the game, if you look up the definition, it basically boils down to telling people what they want to hear, no matter how much bullshit it is, but getting enough people on your side via that.
Right.
Trump did it, and everybody raves about how great he was at it. But here's another part of being a demagogue that he didn't get, which is why he failed ultimately. And there are certain others in that coming along behind him, and name came up in my own head, and I'll share that one with you in a second. It is very much about telling people what they want to hear.
Right.
But it is also very much about knowing when to shut the fuck up or knowing what not to say to people. Trump can't keep his mouth shut because he's a running.
Yeah, it's a faucet.
I'll give you another example. You know who wants to be the new, and the power of that, get people angry enough, get them riled up, incite them. They will follow you. Not only philosophically, they'll follow you all the way into the voting booth in the Electoral College, and they'll put you in the White House no matter what kind of a fucking idiot you are.
Well, Ted Cruz.
There it is. Yeah. See, he wants to be Donald Trump. This is why he's being the asshole that he's being. Because being an asshole, you know, was cool. Being an asshole gets you elected and stuff. The problem with Cruz is, much less so than Trump, but just like Trump, he's clueless. He doesn't know what not to say.
Right.
I would know what to say. I would also know what not to say. And that right there is the key. If somebody in either party, but let's for the moment say the Republicans, because they're out of power and the Republicans, if a demagogue who really ultimately didn't give a frog's fuck about anybody except big, if a Donald Trump came along that had the brain that Donald Trump pretends or, and confesses and demands people believe that he has, which he does not, if the really intelligent Donald Trump is in that Republican Party, step up, buddy. Because now's your chance. They ain't got it.
Now, I'm hoping one of the young ones that are good rise, like Crenshaw or, you know, somebody like that. Actually, you know who?
Joy Behar.
No, I hate to say DeSantis. I mean, he's very popular, and he was the one guy that got he got COVID right. For his state.
That's okay.
You know what I mean?
But the acid test, well, you know what? Just for fun, from here on out, based on what we're talking about today, let's do this. I'll do it, you do it, we'll both do it. Okay. And not just DeSantis, but if somebody else comes into the circle. Let's keep an ear on part two of my conditional thing. Okay. Right. Those are the things he said, and those are the things he's done. Let's see if he's capable of stepping up, or if we see things or see signs in him that he's capable of knowing what not to say.
Right, right.
Because this is the problem with Trump wannabes. They embrace, and this is why I said and was careful to say when I was talking in my original piece about Trump is the cause of and the reason for Trumpism, but he's not the immediate concern anymore. It's the philosophy of Trumpism.
Right, right.
And that's that, you know. I mean, it was hilarious to me. I literally laughed out loud because the guy wasn't kidding. He was serious. This fucking idiot from Texas who said, why aren't we seeing more tweets from the president?
I've often wondered that.
This
myself.
Is what you got as for leadership in your political party is this guy who says that, you know, well, you know, because if they're not, it's almost like, are you faking being a Neanderthal?
Yeah,
if you tweet stupid shit, lots of people will vote for you. So we need to do tweet stupid shit and then people will vote for us. Meanwhile, come on.
It's crazy.
Give me some respect.
It's
all right.
Crazy.
All right. Let me bump this. That's from the video.
The hell is that?
That's from the video of the shooting. The police officer saying, I'm going to tase you. I'm going to tase you.
I'm going to tase you.
And then she pulls the trigger, and as he drives away, and she said, holy shit, I shot him. Now, I threw that in there so and it sounds like shit in the headphones.
When
we listen back on the playback, it sounds clearer. People listening to the show.
I didn't even hear the gun.
Yeah. Well, yeah. No, I didn't hear the gun in the video either.
Right.
I brought it up because it's timely and topical. And just a few hours ago, before we went on air, she's resigned from the police force. Breaking news.
Probably should.
Yeah. Well, you know, a 30-year veteran, it's an unfortunate circumstance. And of course, obviously, this thing has been diced, rediced, hashed, rehashed, and to the point of ad infinitum. All I thought I would do for the purposes of just a touch on to make people a little aware that we are aware of timely and topical things. But let me offer my 18 seconds worth of summation on the whole thing. With the addition of the statement that was made by the police chief there at Brooklyn Center in Minnesota. It's a finger's feet, Jerry. Tim Gannon is the guy's name. Quote, as I watch the video and listen to the officer's commands, it is my belief that the officer had the intention to deploy their taser, but instead shot right with a single bullet. This appears to me that this was an accidental discharge, unquote. I've seen the video. It's grainy, but you can tell it's like a vest cam or a dash cam or whatever. She's got a Glock in her hand or a Sig Sauer or whatever it is their standard deal.
Right, right.
Again, knowing that this has been hashed billions of times already, and you and I don't do that. We look for the stuff under the stuff and talk about more exciting stuff. If a police officer can't tell the difference between a gun and a taser.
Good point.
Wait to see where I'm going here. Then the police department needs to find a new taser manufacturer. Somebody posted a meme earlier today with a picture of a Glock side by side with a picture of one of the tasers that's used somewhere, not in Minnesota. It is pistol-ish.
Is this very similar?
Well, it's bright yellow, which is something that apparently they do in Europe to ensure or help the police officers.
Right.
Because even in a fracas, if you happen to glance down and see metal gray, you go, fuck, I got my gun in my hand.
Right.
This thing looks like a school bus.
Mm-hmm.
It looks a little bit more like a Star Trek. Kind of, you know, sort of thing.
A phaser.
Like a phaser, yeah. But there you go.
Yeah.
Anything to differentiate.
The two, yeah.
The blame lies, and the irony is I didn't know until I saw the article saying that this lady had resigned. She was a 30-plus year veteran of the police force, widely a community involved. I don't know. And she was a training officer, and she was actually training somebody that day.
Oh, wow.
Oopsie. Okay. My summation, as I say, the taser weapon thing needs to be dealt with everywhere immediately. End of story. You don't accidentally discharge something. All I could think of when I read that article, and you know, the family, God bless, and it's
sad.
And you know why the guy was pulled over?
Why?
The air freshener hanging on his rearview mirror was in violation of traffic laws that say you can't have anything that might impede the view of your rearview mirror.
Wow.
And he's dead.
Yeah.
Okay. All I could think of in my dark sense of humor, no pun intended or racism involved, was accidental discharge of the weapon. In the early 70s, mid-70s, probably first, second, third season of Saturday Night Live, back in the Aykroyd Belushi days, Danny Aykroyd and Bill Murray, in one of his first seasons, they did a skit called Ex-Police, as in EX-Police. Mm-hmm. And the premise was these two cops had been cops, but they were rogue idiots, and they'd been thrown off the police force, so their shtick was a parody of a detective series. Their shtick was to... or their gig was to go out and be vigilantes for hire or whatever. And in the opening scene, you got all these low lives and whatever laying around this apartment, and all of a sudden you hear, and the one guy goes, "Yeah, who's there?" And you go, and they don't say anything. And then boom, they kick the door open and they've got like cigs or whatever in their hand. They literally just blow everybody away. And they're all laying there dead, sprawled everywhere. And Aykroyd and Murray are dressed in their suits, and they've got their Glocks in their hands, and they're in the frozen position, and they go,
"Freeze.
Freeze!" Ex-police. Bum, 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 bum.
Yeah. I didn't see any of the video. I didn't really follow that one. I mean, did he comply at all to the police officers?
He got out of the car, and he talked to the officer. Then the officer turned him around and had him not cuffed yet, but still. And there's the conversation is impossible to discern.
Right, right.
And then the hand was pulled back around. In other words, "I'm putting the cuffs on you." And the guy started squirming. Okay. That's going to be second guessed for the rest of Lives.
Yeah. I mean, it's a shame that her career is ruined over something like this, you know.
And not to mention he's dead.
And he's dead, you know. But you know what I'm saying? It's a two part thing. It's not just he's dead. It's a shame a good police officer had whatever happened to her.
Well, I think if you had a variety of expertise, and I'm splitting hairs just to dick with you, but I think that of the two, I think the accidental death of a human being outranks the loss of a job. But yeah, okay,
depends on the human being. But no,
well, just, you know what?
I'm just fucking
with you. Okay.
But yeah, but
you're gonna lose your black audience here if you're not careful.
No, I'm not saying that. I went through something very similar where I was pulled out of the car. Well,
did you intend to shoot him, or did you?
No. I was pulled over in a case of mistaken identity, and I was pulled out of the car, and I was rough. I was manhandled.
Okay.
Basically.
All right.
And they asked me for ID, and I reached for my pocket, and out of the corner of my eye, I saw a young cop. His hand went right to that pistol. He didn't have his gun drawn. It was holstered. But at that moment, I was like, this motherfucker will shoot me if I don't calm down. Mm-hmm. So in my mind, I just completely complied with whatever they wanted, and I'm here today.
I think we're in a vortex. I think I can't. This is total speculation.
Right.
I think now, I can't begin to imagine, I never really could, ever since I was just little enough and old enough to understand anything, but especially so in the last 5 or 8 or 9 years, and especially in the last year or two, I can't begin to imagine what it's like to be a person of color in this country. And, you know, what goes through their mind when something like that happens, and especially somebody apparently like that, who is... what's the problem? And the cop's talking to me about an air freshener on my rearview mirror. And the next thing you know, he's turning me around and he's putting my hand around. Oh God, they're going to kill me. What's your fight or flight kicks in? And I'm just, again, speculating,
right?
Because we'll never know. That's why I purposely thought it through as carefully as I could and said, at the end of the day, these are the kind of mistakes you can't. Well, somebody posted something was darkly, ironically clever. It said, there's just certain jobs you don't fail at.
Exactly.
You don't fail at this job. You don't make those mistakes. Right. You know, you just don't, because you can't.
98% of the police officers are probably fine, but you've got your bad cops.
But they're just, you know, perception.
People can die.
And perception is reality. There's been so much suddenly all of these little bursts of every, it's like, who's the daily victim in whatever case and what we start looking for. Anyway, that's why I said, it's worth 2 minutes and we've done 5 or 7. But the taser is similar to the gun, to the point where you don't know in the heat of something whether you've got a gun or a taser in your hand, then management is failing terribly.
Yeah, you know what I think? Something, I read something somewhere, and it didn't pertain to this case. It was another case a couple years ago. I think also the police officers are supposed to your gun is supposed to be on your dominant hand side, and the taser is supposed to be on your weaker hand side.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I don't. Yeah. Sure, that yeah, makes yeah. sense. That at least that. Sense.
And then,
but having it not be exactly.
Yeah.
This, what I don't understand. And this is the other part. And again, I know that without even having watched any of the cable shows or listening to talk radio, I know this is the kind of shit that's been rehashed already to death. No pun intended. It's this. Oh my God. Instead of, oh my God, I made a horrible mistake in the moment of confusion, and I drew my pistol, realized that I'd drawn my pistol, and I, which immediately would be grounds for termination, if not resigning.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
No, we go accidental discharge, please. And the police chief steps up, and that's not backing your people. That's not protecting your people. That's making bullshit excuses. It's Judge Judy syndrome. That's pissing on her leg and telling them it's raining. Stop that shit.
Yeah.
No, stop it. Stop lying to people. Something's coming up toward the end of the show, which this applies to in a different context, but wanted to share that with you. Recommend. You got something else you want to talk about before we go to the other segment?
No. Go ahead.
All right. Let's do, let's see if I get this right first time.
Smells really good.
It's so tasty, too.
Okay. Are you familiar with Olivia Rodrigo?
No.
Okay. That's because you're old. She's the new thing, man. She's big deal on the pop charts. She's had a number one that was like number one for 62 gabillion weeks called Driver's License. If you haven't heard the song Driver's License. And let me just say, we've been doing this podcast now for 14 years. I don't know. Yeah. Long time. I was going to play a segment of this, but yeah, I'm tired of Facebook and YouTube and their bullshit.
Right,
They print and publish everything that comes down the pipe, but they mute some, you know. So I thought, rather than tempt fate, not going to play you Driver's License, but if you're not familiar with the song, check it out. It's brilliantly written, and it's groovy, man, if I do say so myself. Olivia Rodrigo is 18 years old. She's very talented. Her new song is called Deja Vu, and I wanted to play a chunk of it for you, but I didn't want it to be muted. So very quickly, I'm going to read you this lyric, and you got to trust me when I tell you that the music is cool. I think you'd love the groove. Mm-hmm. It's available on YouTube. Check it out. Cause I went looking, cause I like Driver's License so much. And then I went, I thought, okay. And I just sat there watching her video and listening to the lyrics of this song.
Is she hot?
You're going to make a great dirty old man.
I'm already there, but I'm already there.
Been there since you were 18. All right, check this out. Check this lyric out. And she wrote the song alone. There's none of that shit like those Beyonce songs that have 52 names on there.
Mm-hmm.
With all due
respect. Or Cardi B.
With all due respect to Beyonce, who's the greatest singer in the world. Car rides to Malibu, strawberry ice cream, one spoon for two, and trading jackets, laughing about how small it looks on you, ha, ha, ha. Watching reruns of Glee, being annoying, singing in harmony. I bet she's bragging to all her friends, saying you're so unique. So when you gonna tell her that we did that too? She thinks it's special, but it's all reused. That was our place. I found it first. I made the jokes you tell to her when she's with you. Do you get deja vu when she's with you? Do you get deja vu? Do you call her almost say my name? Because let's be honest, we kind of do sound the same. Another actress, I hate to think I was just your type. And I'll bet she knows Billy Joel because you played her Uptown Girl. You're singing it together. Now I bet you even tell her how you love her in between the chorus and the verse. Ooh. So when you gonna tell her that we did that too? She thinks it's special, but it's all reused. That was the show we talked about. Played you the song she's singing now when she's with you. Do you get deja vu when she's with you? Strawberry ice cream in Malibu. Don't act like we didn't do that shit too. You're trading jackets like we used to do. Yeah, everything is all reused. Play her piano, but she doesn't know that I was the one who taught you Billy Joel. A different girl now, but there's nothing new. I know you get deja vu. She's white. She's 18 years old. She's just a kid. Mm-hmm. She wrote that fucking song all by herself. Very good. It is out of the park.
Very good.
So...
yes.
Old people like are that. Recommending Olivia Rodrigo. And Sukiyaki Kadeki, I can't think of his name.
Oh,
the new Masters winner. We don't recommend him, but still. It's a nice touch.
Did you like that thing I sent you?
Which thing? Oh, the thing where his jacket was laying over the... Well, you know, party's over. What the fuck? Gotta go on.
Like, you may be cool, but you're not that cool.
Not that cool. Yeah, well, explain what you were talking about.
Oh, it's a picture of Hideki... I don't know what it
is. I know. Matsuyama.
Matsuyama, yeah. He won the Masters by 10 strokes.
Well, he was 10 under par. He won by one stroke. He damn near kicked it away.
But there was a picture of him flying back to his home country.
Rio.
And he's Rio. And he's in the airport, and his Masters jacket is folded over and laying over the back of one of the chairs that's next to him.
Yep.
I was like, that's cool.
That's pretty cool.
Because if I won the master jacket, I would sleep in it, shower in it.
Well, I'll tell you something. Somebody juxtaposed, too. I didn't watch. I watched like 4 minutes of the tournament passing through on the way to something else. And at that time, he was 10 under or 11 under, and he was ahead by 5 strokes. And that was on Sunday when there was only like 7 holes to play. And I understand he the pressure kind of rattled him, and he got down to the last hole, and he actually bogeyed the last hole, and he was still only one away. He won by one stroke, so he managed to hang on. But I understand, I didn't see this except later in clips. And this is one of those things that makes me go, I'm tired for a variety of thousands of reasons that we talk about here weekly and we've talked about for several years now on this show, for all the different reasons of the bullshit and the politics and everything else this country has gotten itself into. But the value system and the respect, and I'm tired of not particularly being proud to be an American. This was another one of those things where I went, well, there you go. His caddy, when he putted the last putt and in the hole for bogey, but one stroke up, he's the Masters champion, the first Japanese player to win a major tournament in the PGA. Mm-hmm. He walks away. His caddy replaces the flagstick in the cup and then stands erect and bows respectfully as Japanese custom, I'm sure, and walks away. And I'm thinking, you know, I miss not being that classy.
Right. Yeah, I saw that. That was awesome. Yeah. Yeah, so congratulations to him. He, you know.
And Olivia Rodrigo.
Olivia Rodrigo.
18 years old. When I was 18 years old, I had just discovered my thumbs.
I discovered something
yes.
else.
Yes.
But I played with it all the
time.
We'll
get to that in a minute. All right, let me, believe it or not, mercifully so, we are almost done talking. Got anything worth mentioning besides your hormones out of control?
I got something that's actually pretty funny.
Yeah, but the same difference.
Do you know who Kellen Spadoni is?
No, Gesundheit.
Well, she was arrested yesterday because Charles Schwab in an actual error deposited $1.2 million.
Oh, I saw that. I didn't know her name, but yeah, I saw this. Go ahead.
Into her account. She immediately moved it to another account.
Yeah.
Bought a home and an SUV.
Yeah.
Schwab made an error, transferred the money.
By the way,
she refuses.
Not to interrupt you unduly, but for the majority of our audience, knowing the financial situation of most of our audience, Charles Schwab is an investment broker company. Yes. Yeah. Okay.
So she's refusing to return it.
That's right.
So she was arrested. Actually, I saw on, I think it was MSNBC, they had a prosecuting attorney and a defense attorney. And the defense attorney pretty much said, laid out the letter of the law for theft. And it is like, they put the money in her account.
That's right. And,
you know, I was like, wow. They said she might actually get away with it.
You know, there was a time in my life when I would have been inclined to probably say something along the lines of, well, everyone makes mistakes and it's not her money and let's do the right thing. But I've reached a point in my life where I'm like an old hippie now. Like, you know, fuck the man. There's no accountability anymore. There's no responsibility anymore. I can see the Schwab. Who pushed the wrong button? Who in the world was in a situation where they let $1.2 million go into somebody's account that didn't belong to go there? And you got to know, the chances are they're probably doing the shrug. We'll get the money back. Instead of having his ass fired for those kind of things. So that brings me full circle around to let her keep the money.
Or you know what I'm going to do?
Maybe that'll stop that shit from happening again.
You know what I'm going to do?
Make friends with her as soon as possible?
No, I'm going to open up an account at Charles Schwab and just hope. Come on, baby.
Yeah, well, I have a little teeny tiny stock account with Ameritrade. I'm going to call over to my guys and see if they can hire this this guy who's working for Schwab when he loses his job, if he loses his job.
Yeah, but I thought that was pretty funny.
It is funny.
That's really good.
All right, let me give you this one. This is semi-serious, and I'm going to hit it and quit it. Emily Coletti is a 26-year-old therapist and essayist. Thank God she's not a social media influencer. I don't think I can handle any more of that shit.
Essayist.
Janice Ian of singer-songwriter fame.
Yes. I heard the truth at 17.
She reposted something that Emily posted in one of her blogs or essays, and it was a meme, a little slogan, put it on a bumper sticker or a piece of wood or a charm bracelet or something. It says, "Girls' bodies aren't responsible for boys' thoughts." Okay, I get it. I understand it. I have children. I have grown children. I have grandchildren. I have grown grandchildren, but I've got three granddaughters. I get it. Okay. They're saying that boys need to be responsible for their thoughts, period. And there's that old, and I hate when it's used, but that old business. So women should be able to walk down the street naked if they want to and not be accosted or harassed in any other way. And at its core, that principle is correct.
It's correct, right.
There is a little tiny but. Everybody I know has got a little tiny but. It goes along with it in my money. And this would be seemingly out of character for someone of my age, my generation, my gender, my family, again, father, grandfather. That troubled me. Not so much that it bothered me. I went, yeah. Because that, again, and I'm on a responsibility tear. Have been for months and years, will continue to be. Responsibility, accountability, the new mantra. That little bromide right there absolves women, girls, of all responsibility.
Right.
Men, and again, I got to be very careful here. I'm not defending. I'm not condoning. I'm not irresponsible. Inappropriate behavior is always irresponsible and inappropriate. Try to log that into your medulla as you react to what I'm about to say. Men are genetically predisposed to being stimulated sexually, visually.
Yes.
Women, this is why there's been tons of skin mags making money hand over fist for thousands of years, and Playgirl lasted 20 minutes.
It explains Marilyn Monroe.
There you go. Which isn't to say that ladies don't like to see a fine-looking young man.
Right.
I hate George Clooney, but that's another show. Okay. Brad Pitt. No, I don't. I'm kidding. But see what I'm saying? There's that. And I'm not saying that the whole women walk down the street naked analogy is ridiculous. Yes, everybody needs to be in control of themselves, no matter what their gender is. And there's no excuse for inappropriate behavior. But then there's another thing under the thing with this thing, too. And this is why I'm offering it up. Women, and they're taught this way, and there's been some revolution in that thinking, but it still exists. You got your makeup. You got your perfume. You got your clothing choices. Everything from, well, let's get into be summertime, the thong to the non-existence. Thank you.
Yes.
And what are they for? They are to provoke or evoke a sense of attractiveness. Look at me.
Like a peacock.
Years and years and years ago,
I said cock.
I know. I don't have that on here anymore because all I got is this. All I can give you is the rim shot. I saw a cartoon in Playboy. I don't remember who the cartoonist was, but it was two women walking down the street side by side. They had fishnet dresses on with no underwear. Go-go boots. They had see-through silk blouses. Their boobs were clearly showing. They're walking along the street. There's like nine guys peeking around the corner, all drooling appropriately, you know, looking at them as they walk by, and one is looking at the other saying, "I hate it when men undress you with their eyes." There's a little of that,
right,
that
right.
plays into this too.
Right.
The approach is well-intended. It's my opinion for whatever it's worth. This kind of approach is wrong. Because it absolves responsibility where responsibility needs to be kept on both sides. And to say, well, you know, just that. That's all.
Okay.
All right, let's do a rim shot.
Makes sense.
Well, I'm sorry to hear that. I got a couple of rim shots here I think you'll enjoy. This week, we're going to do one real quick. We do it periodically. This week, this is the build your own punchline rim shot. Here's your ingredients. A Montana 6-year-old found a bullet in a bag of Flaming Hot Cheetos that his dad purchased in a convenience store. The bullet was covered in the, as you might imagine, the hot cheese powder. Now, for your joke, the punchline should include some use of the phrase or a phrase like, when they pry it out of my cold, dead, orange-dusted fingers. This past week saw National Grilled Cheese Day, so Kraft gave away incense that smells like, wait for it, grilled cheese. Huh? And with that, I'm kind of dreading National Gwyneth Paltrow Candle Day.
Love that day.
Smells like pussy. New trend, new fad, too much time on their hands, trying to deep fry water. Apparently, there's some kind of chemical formulational thing that you can take some form of phosphorus or something and put it with water, and it creates just enough of a sphere with the water momentarily where they're trying to get batter and flour on it so they can drop it and fry it like they do at the state fairs. The problem, of course, being that when water comes into contact with hot oil, it basically explodes.
Yes.
So the experts in this medical thing are saying that the fad is, quote, this is a doctor at Johns Hopkins, somewhere between insane and suicidal, unquote.
Nice.
Okay. In a related story, though, never missing an opportunity, McDonald's announces the debut of their new taste treat, the quarter gallon with cheese. Or actually, quarter quart. I think. Or just quart. All right. Kanye is asking for joint custody of the three kids in the divorce with Kim, North, Saint, Chicago, and Psalm, and that's not Saul, that's Psalm, as in the Book of Psalms. The three kids, meanwhile, have filed a motion asking for permission to change their names to something that won't get their asses kicked when school reopens.
And no spousal support.
No.
Did you see that?
They agreed.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're living up to the prenup. They're going their own separate ways. Good for them. Yeah, I never thought I'd say Kanye and Kim are being role models and good examples, but
they seem to have
damned if they're not.
Yeah, all right. An amicable split.
That's what they used to call Kim. You're not the only one with his mind in the gutter. 30,000 people in a poll, 46% of them, this is legit shit, say they would in fact support a run for president by Dwayne The Rock Johnson.
If you smell
and I say,
what The Rock is cooking.
And I say, any guy who can kick the San Andreas faults behind can surely knock Congress on its overpaid fat ass.
There you go.
And I'm right there. Parting shots. Which is not very tasteful on this.
Well, tomorrow, I'm doing some breaking news here. Tomorrow, President Biden is going to announce a total withdrawal of American troops from Afghanistan in the coming months, and with completing the military exit by the 20th anniversary of September 11th on 2021. So 9/11/21 will be the day that we're out of Afghanistan.
Uh-huh.
Do we believe him?
Do I believe him?
Yeah.
Sure, why not?
Well, I'll tell you why. Because
you know,
we were already.
Ted Cruz wants to be Donald Trump. You so badly want to be Tucker Carlson, but you're not going to make it. Go ahead.
I'll tell you why. Because we were already supposed to have the total withdrawal by May 1st.
Did he say May 1st originally?
No. That was negotiated and signed by the Trump administration.
Yeah, old news.
So yeah, I'm
going to give Biden the benefit of the bout. Okay. Now, if September 11 comes and it ain't happening, then we'll have a conversation and I'll be the first one to jump on the bandwagon and say, stop saying things that you don't mean because it just pisses people off.
I'm just wondering if he's extended that time period to escalate or do something else, because we got some military problems around the world. I don't know if you saw the news today.
I can only tell you, for whatever it's worth, and I know that what you just said was a rhetorical question, but if I were president of the United States, I don't give a fuck what the last president did, especially if it's a doofus like Donald. It's my show. Okay. And because if nothing else, I'm going to step up. I'm going to do what I need to do. I'm not looking over my shoulder to anything that been done within reason, of course.
Right,
I'm not
going
to, in fact, so much so that I would not yank us out of agreements and treaties and just for the sake of being able to tweet how big my dick is. But yeah. So, and this is the kind of thing where, hallelujah, they're coming home.
Well,
hopefully he won't have to send them to the border to do patrol down there.
We'll never know. We'll never know because there's a media blackout down there.
Well, we'll see.
And
you know what I think? I think he opens. Well, just a couple of minor things. And again, this could all come back to be wrong and bad, and may not be fruitful and productive. But so far, I'm going to give it. I'm not giving him a grade. I'm not ready to do that yet because it's too soon.
It's incomplete right now.
Well, it's too. Of course, it is. It's too soon. But if I had to, at worst, I'd give him like a B minus because what he's doing is he's doing shit, first of all. And second of all, he's doing shit. He's following his arrow. All right. He's not tweeting. Yeah, he's working. Okay. Yeah. He's not playing golf. He's working.
Yeah. He's.
I'm not saying, hooray, he's working. He's a great guy and everything he does is going to be spectacular, but he's right. Doing the fucking job. And you know what? He's doing it on his terms. Well, you got to have a press conference. No, I really don't. I'll talk to you when I'm fucking good and ready. And I applaud that. And believe me now or believe me later or don't, I don't care. If he was a Republican president and he was doing that, I would say exactly the same thing. It's the style in which he's approaching it. He wasn't hired to please the press. He wasn't hired to show up on my timetable. He wasn't hired. He was hired to do the fucking work and get
that,
the job.
That is true. But we got problems right now. I don't know if you saw the China problem today and the Russia problem.
Name me a period in history that we didn't or don't or haven't.
Well, you know, China warned us today, do not play with fire. After they sent warplanes into Taiwan airspace to get us to stop talking with Taiwan, which we shouldn't.
Okay.
Russia warned the United States today, just another day in the Biden administration, that sending warships into the Black Sea, urging American forces to stay away from the annexed Crimea.
I'm gonna give you a 15-second lesson in your continued effort to align yourself with the Fox News attitude. I'm gonna do an impression.
I don't watch Fox
News. I didn't say you did. I'm saying it's a Fox News attitude. It's being able to take anything and spin it or turn it around in a direction what makes it sound like, oh my gosh, so China's pissed, Taiwan say no, blah, blah, blah. Let me do an impression for you.
Okay.
And this is one that you won't get necessarily because I'm 15 years older than you are, okay? And this is my impression, and then I'll tell you what it is. Know what that is?
What?
1961. You weren't even born yet.
No.
The premier of Russia, the Soviet Union, came to the United States for a visit. He was at the United Nations sitting at the Russian desk. They were talking about something. He didn't like what they were saying because it was some kind of thing that the president, what would be Kennedy at the time, but wasn't there, some kind of policy. And the secretary general said, well, we're going to do this no matter what you think. And we're talking about Nikita Khrushchev, who was the premier of the Soviet Union.
Right.
He took off his fucking shoe and banged it on the desk. At the same time, screaming threats about what we will bury you in Russia. That was 1961. And we thought, oh, my God, we got problems. There's a crisis. It's 2021. And here I sit, baby. My point being what I just said. We've always got problems. It's not about that. We're back to that. We're as close as you can get with Donald Trump still breathing. We're back to that, what I said months ago, when I said I can't wait to get back to the usual fucked up America.
That is true.
So
that is true.
All right. The one other thing I did want to mention real quick because I said.
Oh, D-. D-.
D-.
That would be my grade so far.
I thought you were going to go into some rap or something.
No, well, D-.
I know, but you've made it clear that. I mean, I cut in the middle. I would cut in the middle, whoever it was. D- just shows you bias because you just said yourself like 3 minutes ago it's incomplete.
No, it is. But if you said if I had to give a grade, I'd give a grade. And that's all based on the border. He's fucked the border. He screwed the pooch, bent it over, not even lubed it, just fucked it.
My guest co-host, Tucker Carlson, will be back again next week with more insight and information. I wanted to just throw this out, and I think I may have subconsciously put it in the very end because we got to go, but as my parting shot, because this is good for 20 minutes of conversation, but we ain't going to have it because we ain't got time. Because we just argue, and we've done enough of that today. But I said it would apply to something that was going on with my mantra we talked about earlier. Several movies production companies now have pulled their production out of Georgia because of the vote suppression business and all the rest of that. Guy tweeted two things, and the second one made me go, there you go. And there's the mantra for everything, not just this particular issue, which is always going to be batted around. First of all, he said, Brian Kemp, that's the governor of Georgia, has the power to rescind the racist voter suppression laws he signed. Keep pressuring corporate America because money talks. And that's absolutely true. That's how segregation came to an end in Alabama in the 1960s. Martin Luther King went down there and said, we're not going to burn buildings. We're not going to do this. What we're going to do is the black people aren't going to ride the buses. And 90% of the bus traffic and the bus money that came around in the Alabama was from black people riding the buses. Money talks. That's leverage, like we talked about earlier. The second tweet was in conjunction with that was, he said, actors do not want to work in Georgia. And it's not cancel culture. It's accountability culture. There's my new best friend. Accountability culture. For this issue, fine. We can beat that if you want. But for everything. Accountability, responsibility, first and foremost, for everyone, all the time, everything else is bullshit. Okay? It's just justifying, rationalizing, making excuses, no matter whether you're on the left, whether you're on the right, whether you're in the middle, whatever it is. It's not that complicated. It's just a matter of stepping up and taking responsibility and accountability. Or, and this is the tougher part because this is what's really required, finding some way of creating leverage to insist that those people that don't do it do it and not just fall back on, well, we heard that shit all through the last election cycle and before that. Well, we have a way to solve that problem when the politicians don't, we hold them accountable. It's called an election. And how many times have you heard me say that's bullshit? Because I don't want somebody in a shit job for, you're a manager, you're an employer. Well, that guy sucks. He's doing a terrible job. And God damn it, in 4 years, I'm getting rid of him. You'd fire him before his ass hit the chair you sit down to say, I want to talk to you.
That's happened.
So there you go. All right. And The Rock, I'd vote for The Rock in a minute.
I think, like The Rock.
I like him too, but I think he'd do a great job. I think he'd be a Schwarzenegger type. He'd go in there and not knowing what he's doing, but being a bright guy and a modest guy and a humble guy, he would ask questions of the right people and he would probably get it done.
I agree.
Okay.
I agree.
I hate to end on that note because it's so disconcerting. Anything else you want to say?
No.
Any well wishes you want to send out there? Or?
No, I tell you what does bother me about the stuff in Georgia. And you know, I don't have anything against Biden. I don't mind Biden.
Come on.
That's another story. But, come on. But, when they see he and the liberals seem to indicate that, you know, it's so difficult for blacks
why do you always say liberals and not Democrats? I don't say conservatives. I say Republicans.
Yeah, because I'm not like you.
Clearly.
I'm not going to smear an entire party. There are some reasonable Democrats.
You're smearing an entire character quality. The number of liberals in the world is much, much higher than the number of people in the Democratic Party.
Well, I don't want to offend the Democratic Party. I don't mind offending liberals. Listen, this is the thing that bothers me and even Biden said it in his speech, you know, minorities and blacks have such a hard time, you know, going on the computer. It's like assuming that they're stupid, assuming that they don't know how to go get an ID. That's just one small part of that bill. That's not the whole bill.
You know, I came this close to not going into the discussion with this, and we really are over time.
Yeah.
If you want, I'll put it up front and center for next time, and we'll pick it right up. But let me just give you this as a summation, okay?
Sure.
So that we can.
But that doesn't bother you when he says that?
Well, here's how I think about what's going on with that bill, which kind of encompasses that, and then we can get into the back and forth later. There are things in that, but we talked about some of this last week. There are things in that bill that are ridiculous and nobody needs to be complaining about it. And there are a couple of some good things, some revisions, et cetera. And there's some real fucking stinky cheese in there.
Mm-hmm.
This is the problem with it. And this is the standard operating procedure now for these kinds of things. And especially in this climate of the Republicans are scrambling to try to... I said it. I don't want to say it because it makes it sound like I'm being that guy on the other side. But again, statistically speaking, not because I say so, but because it's true. As a result, in most elections, if not all elections, the larger the turnout, the more likely it is that it's a Democratic vote, and that's made. So the fewer votes get cast, the better chance the Republicans have. The stinky cheese is those things that need to not be in there that make it harder for people to vote when they shouldn't and don't have to. Because everything should be done in this country, ideally, everything should be done to make it as easy and convenient for people to vote as possible. All people, all Americans, all legally registered, blah, 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 and that's more for the discussion.
Right.
My problem with it is the justifications are, he's been ridiculous. Shut the fuck up. If people want water, they can get water. That's silly. All this, they're not complaining about that. They're complaining about the stinky cheese. They're not protesting the water thing or the food thing, because smart people know that's bullshit. What they're protesting is the suppression, these things that are not helping the cause along, and not for one group or another, for everybody. If you don't have any problem, if you are so confident in your policies and your belief that you can make it a better country, then you should be welcoming everybody to come to the polls. If you're trying to keep people from voting, then what does that tell you? And it has nothing to do with party. It has nothing to do with philosophy. It has everything to do with plain common sense. Problem with that bill and those bills like that. Everything else, and that's the core of it. Everything just spokes off of that.
But the problem we're having is in some states and in some areas, there were more votes than registered voters. But that's the things that, I mean, like you said, there are things in this bill that need to be addressed.
Okay.
You know what I mean? But yeah, that's...
No, I'm serious. Yeah. I'm not trying to stop you. We're just at a time thing.
No, I know that.
No, but I want... Let's barring flood, famine, or crisis at the border, part two.
Or be dying from the Johnson & Johnson vaccine.
Whatever else you want to do next week, let's come at the beginning of next week and pick right up right here.
Okay.
And do that.
Yeah.
Okay. That's all I got.
That's all I got.
Okay. God bless. Still wear the mask.
Yes.
We're not done yet. The virus is still calling the shots. Figure it out. A lot of love. Feel a lot of love for everybody. We'll be back next week with, maybe we'll have cake. Maybe
we
not.
We can have cake. No. Maybe your wife will make some cookies.
Boy, how chauvinist is that, huh?
No, she makes great cookies. That's why I wasn't saying that.
Okay. You see how easy these things are misconstrued?
She would leave me cookies around Christmas time.
Yeah, I've been there. I'm the one that put the bag there because
they were delicious.
Them. Okay.
They were delicious.
I'll pass that on to her. So we'll be back next week, God willing, and we feel so sorry for all of you for having to say that. With more of The Blab.